When should you shoot a cop? That question, even without an answer, makes most law-abiding taxpayers go into knee-jerk conniptions. The indoctrinated masses all race to see who can be first and loudest to proclaim that it is never okay to forcibly resist law enforcement. In doing so, they also inadvertently demonstrate why so much of human history has been plagued by tyranny and oppression. In an ideal world, cops would do nothing except protect people from thieves and attackers, in which case shooting a cop would never be justified. In the real world, however, far more injustice, violence, torture, theft, and outright murder has been committed in the name of law enforcement than has been committed in spite of it. To get a little perspective, try watching a documentary or two about some of the atrocities committed by the regimes of Stalin or Lenin or Chairman Mao, or Hitler, or Pol Pot, or any number of other tyrants in history. Pause the film when the jackboots are just about to herd innocent people into the cattle cars, or just about to gun them down as they stand on the edge of a ditch, and then ask yourself the question, when should you shoot a cop? Keep in mind, the evils of those regimes were committed in the name of law. And as much as the statement may make people cringe, the history of the human race would have been a lot less gruesome if there had been a lot more cop killers around to deal with the state mercenaries of those regimes. Now, people don't mind when you point out the tyranny that has happened in other countries, but most have a hard time viewing their own country, their own government, and their own law enforcers in any sort of objective way. Having been trained to feel a blind loyalty to the ruling class of the particular piece of dirt they live on, also known as patriotism, and having been trained to believe that obedience is a virtue, the idea of forcibly resisting law enforcement is simply unthinkable to many. Literally, they can't even think about it. And humanity has suffered horribly because of it. It is a testament to the effectiveness of authoritarian indoctrination that literally billions of people throughout history have begged and screamed and cried in the face of authoritarian injustice and oppression, but only a tiny fraction have ever actually lifted a finger to try to stop it. Even when people can recognize tyranny and oppression, they still usually talk about working within the same system that's responsible for the tyranny and the oppression. People want to believe that the system will, sooner or later, provide justice. The last thing they want to consider is that they should illegally resist, that if they want to achieve justice, they must become criminals and terrorists, which is what anyone who resists legal injustice is automatically labeled. But history shows all too well that those who fight for freedom and justice almost always do so illegally, i.e., without the permission of the ruling class. If politicians think that they have the right to impose any law they want, and cops have the attitude that as long as it's called law, they will enforce it, what is there to prevent complete tyranny? Not the consciences of the lawmakers or their hired thugs, obviously. And not any election or petition to the politicians. When tyrants define what counts as law, then by definition, it is up to the lawbreakers to combat tyranny. Pick any example of abuse of power, whether it's the fascist so-called war on drugs, the police thuggery that has become so common, the random stops and searches now routinely carried out in the name of security, such as at airports, border checkpoints that aren't even at the border, sobriety checkpoints, and so on, or any other example. Now, ask yourself the uncomfortable question. If it's wrong for cops to do these things, doesn't that imply that the people have a right to resist such actions? And of course, state mercenaries don't take kindly to being resisted, even nonviolently. If you question their right to detain you, interrogate you, search you, invade your home, and so on, you are very likely to be tasered, physically assaulted, kidnapped, put in a cage, or shot. If a cop decides to treat you like livestock, whether he does it legally or not, you will usually have only two options: submit or kill the cop. You can't resist a cop just a little and get away with it. He will always call in more of his fellow gang members until you are subdued or dead. Basic logic dictates that you either have an obligation to let law enforcers have their way with you, or you have the right to stop them from doing so, which will almost always require killing them. Politely asking fascists to not be fascists has a very poor track record throughout history. Consider the recent Indiana Supreme Court ruling, which declared that if a cop tries to illegally enter your home, it's against the law for you to do anything to stop him. Aside from the patent absurdity of it, since it amounts to giving thugs with badges permission to break the law and makes it a crime for you to defend yourself against a criminal if he has a badge, consider the logical ramifications of that attitude. There were once some words written on a piece of parchment, those words now known as the Fourth Amendment, that said that you have the right to be free from unreasonable searches and seizures at the hands of government agents. In Indiana today, what could that possibly mean? The message from the ruling class is quite clear and utterly insane. It amounts to this: we don't have the right to invade your home without probable cause, but if we do, you have no right to stop us, and we have the right to arrest you if you try. Why not apply that to the rest of the Bill of Rights while we're at it? You have the right to say what you want, but if we use violence to shut you up, you have to let us. I can personally attest to the fact that that is the attitude of the U.S. so-called Department of Justice. Or maybe, you have the right to have guns, but if we try to forcibly and illegally disarm you and you resist, we have the right to kill you. Ask Randy Weaver or the Branch Davidians about that one. You have the right to not testify against yourself, but when we coerce you into confessing and call it a plea agreement, you can't do a thing about it. What good is a right? What does the term right even mean if you have an obligation to allow jackboots to violate your so-called rights? It makes the term absolutely meaningless. To be blunt, if you have the right to do A, it means that if someone tries to stop you from doing A, even if he has a badge and a politician's scribble, sometimes called law, on his side, you have the right to use whatever amount of force is necessary to resist that person. That's what it means to have an unalienable right. If you have the unalienable right to speak your mind, a la the First Amendment, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to shut you up. If you have the unalienable right to be armed, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to disarm you. If you have the right to not be subjected to unreasonable searches and seizures, then if all else fails, you have the right to kill government agents who try to inflict those upon you. Those who are proud to be law-abiding don't like to hear this and don't like to think about this, but what's the alternative? If you do not have the right to forcibly resist so-called legal injustice, that logically implies that you have an obligation to allow government agents to do absolutely anything they want to you, your home, your family, your neighbors, and so on. Really, there are only two choices. You are a slave, the property of the politicians without any rights at all, or you have the right to violently resist government attempts to oppress you. There can be no other option. Of course, on a practical level, openly resisting the gang called government is usually very hazardous to one's health. But there's a big difference between obeying for the sake of self-preservation, which is often necessary and rational, and feeling a moral obligation to go along with whatever the ruling class wants to do to you, which is pathetic and insane. Most of the incomprehensible atrocities that have occurred throughout history were due in large part to the fact that most people answer never to the question of when should you shoot a cop. The correct answer is, when evil is legal, become a criminal. When oppression is enacted as law, become a lawbreaker. And when those violently victimizing the innocent have badges, become a cop killer. So the next time you hear of a police officer being killed in the line of duty, take a moment to consider the very real possibility that maybe in that case, the law enforcer was the bad guy and the cop killer was the good guy. As it happens, that has been the case more often than not throughout human history.
Alpha Team report.
What's happening, Heather?
Alpha Team has been responding.
Bravo.
Still nothing.
You lost both teams? Get a grip on this operation, Heather. That's bored. Green light, yes, sir.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time. Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You are too naive to see the truth. There's no bringing in Bourne.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the laws. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is August 16th, 2016, and I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, and you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com and to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and now iTunes. We were always on iTunes, but then we weren't for a little while, and then I believe we were back on there, and I didn't even realize it might have been that we were off for maybe 48 hours while I changed the feed. But we are back on iTunes, so if you are an iTunes listener, and that's where you listen to all your music and podcasts, you can get us on iTunes. So many different places to get us if you listen to the podcast, of course. I'd prefer you listen live, but a listen is a listen. As long as you listen to the show, it doesn't really matter to me. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we, of course, are always happy to hear from you, and you can reach us via phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. Or via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Just send a contact request, your name and what you want to talk about, and we will get you on the air. Also, check us out at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. That's where you'll find links, the specific links to all of the archived content. Of course, you can go to any of those sites and search for the show, and you'll easily find it if you type in Nonpartisan Liberty for All. But if you want the just want to click on the link, go to NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. That is our official website, where you will find the links to not only my show, but also the Illumination Hour and its own page. You will find most of the archives I post usually every weekend, so they're behind. But and, of course, original articles that are posted there. So, and we do have a new show. We are planning on starting the show on September 12th at 5 p.m. Pacific, 8 p.m. Eastern, and that would be the, I have to find the exact name that we decided on because it wasn't really up to me. Well, I mean, I guess I could have, I influenced the name, I guess, because I made a suggestion, but ultimately it was up to him. It's his show. So it is the Threat Management Center show, Public Safety Through Nonviolence, with host Dale Brown. Now, for those of you that are familiar with Dale Brown or not familiar with Dale Brown, he is the owner and president, working president of, I think that's what his title is. I've never actually asked him what his title is, commander. Possibly he runs the Detroit Threat Management Center. And I've talked, we've had him on the show before. I actually found the show. It's 127. Unfortunately, it's before we improved the sound. I was listening to it, and the sound isn't as good as it is now. I mean, now we have probably as good as you can get sound-wise. You know, maybe you can get a little better for a professional show on a radio station, but I mean for an internet show. And back then, unfortunately, our sound wasn't as good, but it still was a great show. Dale had a lot of stories, and he'll be back on this week on Thursday. We're going to start the show early at 6 o'clock Pacific, 9 o'clock Eastern. But he'll be starting his own show September 12th at 5:30 Pacific. Again, 8:30 Eastern. And that will be every Monday at 5:30 Pacific, 8:30 Eastern, right before the Illumination Hour. So it should be about an hour, but in case we go over, there is some time between the Illumination Hour and his show. So, you know, if we go over by 15 minutes or whatever, of course, I still have time to prepare to air Ellen Stallone's show, which is doing great, the Illumination Hour, and is a great show. So you can tune in to Dale's show and then continue to tune in to Ellen's show. And that will be every Monday starting September 12th. Ellen's show, of course, is already on. It aired last night, her 11th show. So it airs every Monday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. So tune in for that. And of course, as I had mentioned, we air Nonpartisan Liberty for All at 7 o'clock Pacific, Tuesday through Thursday. So on our last show on Thursday, at the beginning of the show, I spoke a little about korrryn-gaines. And I didn't feel like I had enough information, as that was the day I found out about it. And with all the research I did, and there's articles all over the place, of course, but it didn't really get the coverage that I originally thought it did, because it was covered on Fox News on the Kelly file. That was the biggest national coverage that I saw. I think it was in the Washington Post as well. So newspaper wise, but as far as TV, government media, I didn't see a lot of coverage. Now, of course, you know, on YouTube, and if you go searching for articles, you find a lot of independent media and, you know, people on YouTube that are YouTube characters or whatnot that have spoken about it. Some of them very, I know this isn't even really a word, but ignorantly, or they were very ignorant in their videos. But, and I have some of them, and even Willie D from the Ghetto Boys, and I'm 99% sure it's him because it looks like him and it sounds like him. And I've, you know, been a fan of actually the Ghetto Boys since, 1990. So I have a clip from him too, which I don't totally agree with. The reason I think this didn't get the government media coverage, and first of all, let's go back and put this in perspective when it comes to police killings. And to do that, I'll even go to killed by police, killedbypolice.net. And you can also go on Facebook, is a site that tries to document every police killing. And they also back it up with an article. Now, there could be other articles. I don't know, you know, how they choose their articles, because essentially every local paper, for the most part, or local newscast, they don't link to the local newscast, but they link to an article, whether it's the local paper or if it becomes a national story, which more and more have, but really not as many as you think. I mean, it's still probably less than 10 in the past 2 years out of, you know, 2 years of police killings, the average, and I could probably find out the exact number this year so far, 728. And that's, it's probably more. That's just according to Killed by Police. So keep in mind that, you know, looking at the 16th, three people were killed. Looking at the 15th, two people were killed. The 13th, and two, three, four, five, six people were killed. It's an average. It really comes out to, because I'm adding in the fact that Killed by Police may miss some of these. And they might not be missing them because of anything that they're doing, but I mentioned this before that you may have cops that murder people and they just disappear and you never find those people. Now, they're not going to be in Killed by Police lists, and they're not going to be in the paper as, you know, killed by a cop, because obviously they just disappeared. They're going to be maybe reported as a missing person at some point, but you don't know. So they also now put sex and race, and I can see the last person was white. It doesn't mean that every single person, actually the most, like the last 10, they only have race on about three of them. Sometimes they don't say in the articles that they link to, but a lot of times you can find out. But in the last 10 that they have actually identified the race, there were two white males, a Latino male and a black male. So, and it's just a fact, because of population, that more white people are killed by police than any other race, just because white people make up, I think, 70% or 69% maybe now of the population. It's getting smaller as the Latino population gets bigger. And then they kind of divide. I don't know how they're doing that now, because there used to be black Hispanic or white Hispanic. So they can take Hispanic or Latino as one whole, which is basically like Spanish speaking countries, which I don't know how you can just throw that all together. But they'll take that and then if they want to break it out, they can break it out to Black Hispanic or White Hispanic. Like, there are Dominicans that are darker than the majority of Black people in the United States. I mean, that are darker than people in Africa. And they would be considered Black Hispanic. So it depends when it comes to that. But I think just if they're, for classification purposes, if they're from, you know, South America, the Caribbean, they're considered, or their heritage is from that, you know, in Mexico, of course, they're considered Latino. And I would think that the biggest Spanish or I was going to say Spanish speaking countries, but biggest Latino populations come from Mexico, Puerto Rico, and I don't know what the third country would be, possibly Cuba. Puerto Rico, of course, is part of the United States. So, you know, you just have to move to the mainland, really. Actually, Puerto Rico stats are usually counted because they're part of the United States. But so that was a kind of fucked up thing, really, because technically all Puerto Ricans are Americans. But I'm saying, I guess, Puerto Ricans that are on the mainland is more what I meant. Hispanic population that's on the mainland, and then of course Mexicans, and I don't know what the third would be, and that's just my own, you know, estimate as to what I think. I'm not sure, but I know Mexicans make up a big. It's kind of weird because out west, the Hispanic population is mostly Mexican. My fiance is 100% of Mexican heritage. And I only say it that way because she says it that way, whatever. And on the East Coast and the mainland, the majority of Hispanic population or Latino population is Puerto Rican. For the most part, I mean, I just know that from living there, you know, when I lived in Boston, most of the Hispanic people that I knew were Puerto Rican. And when, of course, in Las Vegas, the majority, and I think I know this for a fact, that the majority of Hispanic population, because I looked it up and I recall that the majority of Hispanic population in Las Vegas is Mexican. Of course, Mexico's right there. Now, I didn't mean to get into a big conversation about that. The point is that you have all these people getting killed by police, but the amount of national stories, national coverage is minimal. Look at the past 2 years. And that's really before that. How many times have you even heard the government media, national media, talk about somebody being killed by a cop? It had to be something huge. Or, you know, Rodney King was at a time where not a lot of people had people had video cameras. Like, I had a video camera back then. I used to run around as a kid with a video camera. But I obviously didn't bring it everywhere. I mean, they were big VHS video cameras. So it's not like now where you always have your phone on you and you can record stuff. So a beating like that, although I hope there's not beatings to that point. I mean, if you look at the injuries on Rodney King, I mean, it was bad. Now, I wouldn't be surprised if there's, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50 beatings a day in this country, at least, if not more. But I hope they're not to that extent. you know, I would hope they wouldn't happen at all. But I mean, that's just not being realistic. But my point being that until, you know, that was a story because it got on tape. And back then, what the fuck got on tape? And who saw that the police would do stuff like that? Like that back then, I don't think, and people have said this as well from the police department, that nothing's really changed. The thing that's changed for the most part, things that might may have changed a little, but for the most part, the biggest thing that has changed is the internet and social media and cameras in your pocket. Good ones, too. So everybody has a camera and can pull out a camera and get something on tape. The problem is even when you get something on tape, people don't get convicted. So in the past couple years, really, at the most, there's maybe been 10 national stories that I'm aware of. And I don't consider this one really a national story. It's borderline. It's gotten more attention than most killings by police because of the circumstances. But it's not like the Michael Brown case, which is probably the biggest one. And you had Eric Garner, and then these two recent stories, Fernando Castillo and Spencer or Alton Spencer. And those are the only four that come to mind right away as far as national stories. There may be a couple more that I'm just not thinking of. But so, I mean, it's probably closer to 5 than 10 that. So people that are morons that just follow government media and that's all they do, unless somebody gets killed within their city, and it's usually on, you know, it's not a top story usually, and maybe they don't even wait to see it, but they think that, oh, these are the only people that are getting killed by the police. They're not realizing that over, you know, thousands of people each year are getting killed by police. So if we're saying now, if killed by police can identify 728, and I would say that it's probably, you got to factor in a margin of error, and you have to factor in people that disappear. And I think that's a lot more than you think. I would say it's got to be at least 800. And who knows what it's going to wind up at the end of the year. And that's why I say I average it around 1,400. Now, I give or take, I could be off by a couple hundred or 100 or something like that. But when you're talking about a number over 1,000, that is at least 2015, because they've only been doing this a couple years. 2015, their number was 1,207. So, you know, if I say, again, 1,400, it's not, it's a little more, but I'm accounting for those other things. So they have 1,207 that they can actually verify. So I need to always make that point when I'm talking about police that are killing people, because people think, because of the stories that government media covers, that it's only black people getting killed by police. And that it's only, you know, oh, only like 20 people a year or something get killed by police. Now, for people that follow this stuff and are researching it and looking at things like killed by police and independent media and things like that, that, you know, will take the local articles and post them, or take a local article and then rewrite the article and post it to their site. We know what's going on with that, but the majority of people, I mean, I don't know how many people actually do that. Now, I know a lot of people are sick of government media and think it's a bunch of bullshit, but there's still enough that will of the voting public and of all that shit that are watching, you know, the nightly news every night, watching the CBS nightly news or NBC nightly news, and watching their local news. And they're just getting bullshit, because as I've said before, it's not only what you show or how you cover something, it's also about what you show or what you don't show. So this whole thing that only black people are getting killed by police is totally untrue. Now, that doesn't mean that racism doesn't exist and that there's not racist cops, because there is. I mean, that's a fact of life. Racism does exist and there are racist cops. Now, is that why they killed them? I tend to think it's more, some people would call it racism. I to call it more prejudice. But it still falls into being black. So if they, you know, thinking all young black kids or all young black men are, you know, criminals or whatever, having that state of mind. And there's other things I think that factor into it, where they are or whatever. But I think a lot of police have that attitude or have that mentality that, you know, all black people are criminals. However, as I've said before, the problem is the police and the power that they have. And I don't believe the police should exist, because they're killing, you know, it's the power thing. And that's why they, I mean, it, this is not, and I always have to say this, this is not just about people getting killed. It's about people being harassed, people's rights being violated, all of these things. And it's only getting worse, and there's only more and more laws being passed. And of course, they're talking about federalizing the police, which is their answer to stop people from getting killed. So that's why I, you know, and tomorrow we'll talk again about Black Lives Matter, but we'll talk about their, whatever you want to call it, their demands or their, what they're about. Or what they want, which has nothing, not much to do with police, to be honest. It has to do with, you know, some of the, there's things here and there, but the major theme is a lot of communist ideas. And it's obvious that it's a hijacked movement that somebody's put a lot of money into to serve a political purpose. And we'll talk about that tomorrow, but it's fucked up. I'll just put it that way. And one of the things that I read was how they don't want private schools to exist. Now, I don't know if that means, it has to mean for everybody. Most of the things just say for black people. We want reparations for black people or this for black people. But private schools, they don't want for anybody. So things like that. There's an agenda in there. So basically what has happened, which reminds me of the Trayvon Martin case, where what has happened is people claimed that the whole thing was racist, and then it turned around at the end to protesting self-defense laws and gun laws because it was hijacked and taken over. There are trained protesters. I remember talking to somebody, and this is even from the 70s, and they were training protesters. They, being the powers that be or political operatives or political, people that control politics, they put together a lot of these things. You know, no movement can become that big without somebody with a lot of money funding them. It's just a fact. But we'll talk about that tomorrow. But the reality is not what they're not in reality, and neither is the government media, and neither are a lot of people, to be honest. Because the reality is that as people that live in the United States, the government, essentially, because you can't just put it on the police. It's the politicians. I've said this before, the judges, the prosecutors, all of them, they're all involved in this. The police are just at the end. They're the dogs that are doing the bidding of their masters. But they're just as culpable. I'm not saying that they're not as culpable, but people keep giving, I think, passes to everybody else that's involved. It's like a mafia and only blaming the hitmen and not the, you know, heads of the mafia or the people along the line or in the chain of command. So anyway, I had talked about, we did a show on Black Lives Matter on Thursday, but this was before the, I think the demands had come out, but I just became aware of them. So we really didn't talk about those. And I don't think they call them demands. They call them something else, but whatever. So before that, I talked about korrryn Gaines and what I knew up to that point. And I think I held back to an extent because I wanted to make sure that I felt comfortable with the information that I had. So I went out and did more research and tried to find everything that I could, which really wasn't much. I mean, you just get the same stories written over and over again for all these different publications, different opinion pieces, which are basically one side or another. You did get that Fox News coverage on Megyn Kelly's show, which I had played, and I'll probably play again tonight. And really what it comes down to, and even me, to be honest, you know, thinking about some of that stuff, to an extent, you know, being careful about what I say, you know, because I know people are listening to me and it's not being paranoid. I've talked about the, in one day, like all my shows were downloaded out of some town in Virginia, right near, right next to DC. So, there's probably millions of people that are being, you know, filtered through some machine that has these algorithms or whatever, or they're collecting, you know, shows like this, and maybe they run them through there. I don't know what they do with them. I know they're not sitting down and listening to them. They don't have time, but they have automated programs, and I would think that they would probably run them through there, and then they, if something gets flagged or whatever, they'll maybe look at it. I don't know. But I know everything we say and everything we do is being recorded and stored in a database. That doesn't mean it's being listened to. However, it can be at some point. And as artificial intelligence gets more intelligent, the more they can do with that information. And of course, as they pass laws and take more of your freedom away, there may be things that you're doing now that are legal that won't be legal in the future. And that information may be used against you. We're, you know, I don't really convey this because I don't want to be negative. I want to be more positive and just get the information out there. I mean, the goal of the show is really to promote the ideas of what I call true freedom and liberty, and, you know, expose the government for really what I say at the beginning of the show, expose the government for what it really is, and let people know what's going on that affects your freedom and liberty, and also philosophical concepts like self-ownership and things like that, and how you're being oppressed and you don't even realize it. So in this story of korrryn-gaines, and there's some more stuff that I had learned, and I look at her in a way as somebody who stood up by not complying and then stood up to defend herself when her house was broken into by a bunch of cops. Now, just saying that alone, I know that a whole bunch of people hear that and, you know, oh, you're fucked up and whatever. So let me explain how I come to that conclusion and all of the things, because there were a lot of stuff that was out there that was bullshit. And you have a whole, because of Facebook, really. So don't use Facebook if you want a live stream. There's live stream, there's Bamboozer. Don't live stream off of Facebook. Because what they did was they shut her Facebook account down because she was live streaming stuff. I have a slight issue with what happened with the kids. But I can understand to an extent some of the things. And also, I mean, she was 23 and had a 5-year-old. So this is a girl who, you know, had a kid at 18, probably got pregnant at 17, and was with a 39-year-old as well at 23. So, you know, I don't know what had happened before that, and I don't know anything about her family, if they were supportive in her life. And if they helped her with taking care of her kids and whatever. And I'm not going to say that she's, you know, mother of the year. But I do believe, and I'm not suggesting people do this, but I do believe she's somebody who said that, I'm not going to be your fucking slave anymore, and I'm not going to comply with this. And if you break in my house, which essentially they did, and we'll get into the details on that, when we get to that point. But that I don't believe this is right. I'm not going to comply with it. And I'm going to defend myself. I'm not going to be locked in a cage. Now, one of the things that had come to my attention was the fact that she, for whatever reason, didn't show up for court. But there is a video, and this is the video that I didn't see until later, which is the whole reason why I wanted to wait and do a whole show on her with more information. There's a whole video of her going to the police station to try to get her court information. So I guess when she got out of jail, they gave her, you know, her court date and whatever information. I would think it's just your court date and the court you have to appear in and what you're charged with. They usually won't give you the police report. You'll have to get it. But it depends on, I mean, this is the state of Maryland, so I don't know. But they will give you what you're charged with and an explanation of what you're charged with, at least they should, and your court date. So she was probably already arraigned and was the next step would have been her pretrial hearing. Now, she went to the police station to get this information and said, I need to get this to my lawyer and I need to get this information. And they didn't have it. They had told her, you know, kind of gave her the runaround with it and said, call this person. And I know, unfortunately, from experience with courts, how they can easily, and they could have done this on purpose, but it could have been a mistake that they could get, she could have called and got the wrong court date, or they could have gave her the wrong court date, or they could have told her that it was moved to another date. There's nothing that I see. Now, again, this is one video, but she was very adamant in this video about, you know, her lawyer and making sure she got to court. And again, from what I understand, and I don't have any knowledge that says otherwise, is that this would have been her pretrial hearing. So why would she be, you know, if she decided, hey, fuck it, I'm not showing up for court, why would she get a lawyer, go there to get her information? She actually pushed to get this information that she didn't get it right away. She kept asking. She said, can I see your supervisor? And they won't come out. Can I see their supervisor? She said how much she needed this information. So what it seemed like to me is that this was definitely a person that wanted to show up for court. And in a pretrial hearing, it's never going to be the final, I guess, unless you somehow make a deal at that point. But it's not like you have to worry about going to jail at that point. So there was no reason for her to not show up, and it doesn't seem like on her part that she had any intention of not showing up. Especially, usually people that try to use some of the sovereign citizen defenses, and again, some of this shit is actually true, but it doesn't work because the judges do whatever the fuck they want to do. So it doesn't matter what the law is. They interpret it the way they want. They get around it. And the things that may be true, now some of them are just kind of ridiculous, but there are some things that I believe are true. It's just they won't recognize it. and I've said this before, I said, it doesn't matter. You know, people would tell me, well, this is how it is and whatever. And I said, fine, but tell that to the judge or tell that to the fucking police or whoever. And they don't care. So it doesn't matter. So even with her, well, I'll wait till I get into exactly what happened. But usually they like sovereign citizens like to use, or people that consider themselves sovereign citizens, which it looked like she did, which would also make her more of a constitutionalist, which is not in line with Black Lives Matter. So I don't know. What it seemed like to me is I don't know how she could have anything to do with Black Lives Matter, especially when they released their demands or their whatever they call it, which was a bunch of communist bullshit for the most part. So her not showing up for court, just it doesn't make any sense. So what I think happened, and this is just speculation, is that either somebody, they told her that the court date was moved, or they gave her the wrong date or something to that effect is what I believe happened. Whether that's the case or not, I don't know, but it doesn't seem like she had any reason on her part, or not any reason, but that she had any intention of not showing up for court. Now, what had happened and the whole reason why she was arrested in the first place, although she could have avoided that, she didn't have a license plate, and I don't believe she had insurance. That's still, I'm still not clear on. But, and then they had charged her with, like, you know, resisting or disorderly conduct and all that bullshit as well. But they pulled her over, and she had a cardboard plate that said, I don't remember exactly what it said, but it said something, you know, probably I think about right to travel or whatever. And I had brought up before that everybody should take off their license plates because, one, the government is using it for things they should not be using it for. They're using it to track everywhere you go. That is not supposed to be the intention of a license plate, where they have license plate readers and things like that. So, yeah, I actually agree with that, as in protest and in noncompliance, to take off your license plate. Now, to do it on your own isn't the smartest thing, because if it's just you, what's going to happen to her is what's going to happen. If you get, you know, 10,000 people to do it in your city, what are they going to do? You know, they're going to arrest everybody when they don't comply with the license plate and they don't comply with paying your ticket. Well, what are you going to do at that point? You going to arrest 10,000 people for that? No. So the what she was doing, although I don't agree, I'm not against it, but I don't agree with the whole sovereign citizen thing, because I believe in your natural rights, that you are born with certain rights, and pretty much as long as you don't hurt anybody else, or including their property, you should be able to do whatever you want. And, you know, something like a license plate, nobody ever consented to paying for the registration of a car. I know they say it's a privilege and whatever. Now, I thought of that as more, okay, that's something to do, and I think it's warranted based on what they're using it for, because they're using it for something that they're not supposed to be using it for. So she was doing it as an act of noncompliance, and I support her in that. Now, in the car, she told her kids if the cops try to take them out of the car, because basically they were going to tow her car. They told her and they were going to give her a ticket. They told her if she got out of the car, basically they were just going to give her a ticket and she could go and she was near her house. But she refused to get out of the car. Now, the way, you know, being with her two kids and, you know, in that situation, I would just get out of the car and kind of cut your losses at that point. I understand what she's trying to do, but at the same time, there's picking your battles. And I think that one was just, there was nothing good that was going to come out of that. So I think she should have just got out of the car and let them tow the fucking thing. But she stood her ground and said, no, you have no right. And of course, they removed her from the car and arrested her and then charged her with disorderly conduct as well and all the traffic violations. So that was what initially, and I think she said in the video that she believes she spent 2 days in jail, which seems ridiculous. She got released on personal recognizance, but still was in jail for 2 days. And which seems like punishment more than what the quote unquote crime was in this situation. It seems like a ridiculous punishment. So, and that she should have been released, you know, in a couple hours. But that's what got her court date in the first place. And, you know, telling your kids to do that, they were little, so it's not like the police are going to do anything. But I'm, you know, I believe in peaceful parenting and stuff like that. Not that that is against it. It's not her hitting her kids. But at the same time, letting your kids grow up to decide for themselves their opinions on a lot of things. But at the same time, you know, letting them know what's going on. So, you know, again, she's a young mother. She had kids really young. And that might be a factor in what had happened. Now, I don't know that for sure, but that's possible. So, again, I believe that she should have at that point just said fuck it and let them tow the car. But I give her, in a way, I give her credit for standing her ground. But really what she did was civil disobedience, because if you're going to do, to me, noncompliance is then you defend yourself. And she ended up doing that later. But the self-defense came later, not at that point. And she should have just, like I said, the best case scenario there would have been to just leave with the kids. And, you know, if she wanted to fight it in court, she could have done that and used some of that sovereign citizen stuff. And hopefully, you know, the sovereign citizen people, hopefully a lot of them, you know, learn from that and realize government for what it really is. And it's not about, well, you know, this law or that law, and realize that government's going to do whatever the fuck they want to do, no matter what the laws are. And government extorts you. Government is oppressive. And to look at that side of it as opposed to well, I'm following the law technically, but I'm following these laws, type thing that they don't tell us. Now, it's still looking at it as, well, government is trying to hide shit from us. Government's trying to oppress us because we don't have the knowledge. But it's something that it might bring people into the quote unquote freedom movement or whatever you want to call it, or into the ideas of freedom. But it's not a way to go, in my opinion. But she stood her ground, didn't get out of the car and said, fuck it, I'll get arrested. But again, that's like civil disobedience, really. It's when you don't refuse to get arrested and defend yourself is when it's not civil disobedience. So I'm going to take a break. When we come back, we'll get to the story of what had happened when a warrant was issued. How and why, again, we don't have that information. They claim she didn't show up for court. We won't get to ask her, did they fuck with her with the court date or anything like that? Obviously, because they killed her. But, I think that's really what happened. But I don't know. Anyway, you can find us at Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And if you'd like to call in or Skype into the show, 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664, or username Nonpartisan Liberty for All on Skype. And you can find all that information at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. So I'm going to take a quick break. Well, maybe not quick, but I'm going to play some of these clips that I have on Korrryn, and we'll be back after this. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com.
Joining me now, criminal defense attorney and former prosecutor Mark Eiglarsh and criminal rights. Breaking tonight, a new national uproar after police shoot a suspect near Baltimore and touch off a huge wave of controversial media coverage. Welcome to the Kelly File, everyone. I'm Megyn Kelly. Many Americans awoke to the heartbreaking news today that a young black mother, korrryn-gaines, had been killed and her young son wounded after a nearly six-hour standoff with police on Monday. What was missing from some of those initial reports, however, was the fact that Gaines was allegedly pointing a shotgun at the responding officers as she sat on the couch with a five-year-old child. Police were attempting to serve arrest warrants to Gaines and a man named Kareem Courtney early Monday. No one answered at Gaines' apartment, but the officers could hear voices inside, including those of children. Here's how police described what happened next.
They could clearly see a female that they believed to be Miss Gaines seated on the floor, a child nearby, who immediately began to wield a shotgun around, bringing it up to ready position, pointing it directly at the officers there to serve the arrest warrants. The entire time throughout the afternoon, she repeatedly would point the weapon at our personnel. For hours, we pleaded with her to end this peacefully. We were concerned about the safety of the child.
Gaines was even filming off and on as those hours unfolded, her young son's voice still in the background as she zoomed in on the rifle of an officer who was peering in the door at one point. And in another gut-wrenching video taken during the standoff, Gaines asks her young son whether he is aware of the situation in which she has put him.
What's happening right now? Who's outside?
The police.
And what are they trying to do? It's charging. What are they trying to do?
They're trying to kill us.
They're trying to kill us. In moments, we're joined by Pastor Wesley West and radio host Kevin Jackson on the controversy over how this thing ended and where the story has gone since. But first, tonight, we begin with Trace Gallagher, who has the details that a lot of media outlets left out. Trace?
Megan, prior to the 5.5-hour standoff, Baltimore police were very aware of 23-year-old korrryn Gaines. Back in March, they pulled her over with her kids for not having a car license plate. Instead of the plate, there was a cardboard sign warning government officials not to stop her. And when police did, it quickly got confrontational. And korrryn Gaines videotaped it and posted parts of it on Instagram. Watch.
You won't. Listen.
Honestly, I'm giving you all these chances. Why are you acting?
A chance to do what?
To get out of your car with your children.
Sir, you're trying to steal my car. When you put your hands on me, I promise you, you will have to murder me. You will have to murder me. So go ahead and get ready to do that.
Gaines was finally arrested and given a court date. When she failed to appear, Baltimore police went to her home to serve a bench warrant. Police say they could hear the man inside talking with her, but nobody came to the door, so they got a key from the manager, opened the door, and found Gaines sitting on the floor with a shotgun. Police backed away and the barricade began. A short time later, the man inside ran out with a one-year-old baby and was arrested. Gaines stayed in the home with her five-year-old son. Police negotiators brought in her parents and a psychologist, saying they made every effort to get the woman to surrender. All the while, Gaines was posting on social media, and her followers were encouraging her not to surrender. Police filed a request with Facebook and Instagram to disable her account, but it took more than an hour. And this is the final Instagram post. Watch again.
What's happening right now? Who's outside?
Just while this is going on here or being mentioned here, because I don't want to have to go back to it later and forget about it. The fact that the police can shut down your accounts is a scary thing in itself. Now, I don't give a fuck what the circumstances are to allow the police to shut down. So it took an hour. So what did they do in that hour? That's pretty quick too, to get an account shut down. And what they did by that is she was filming from what I understand, directly to Facebook, because they have that now. And that's why I said film the bamboozer or live stream it or something. But we don't know at a certain point, there's no video. The cops did have body cameras. I guess their excuse is they just got them like a couple weeks ago or a month ago. So what that fucking means, I don't know. So the cops don't have any video of it. So as far as what happened from the point of her video going out, you don't know. You just know what the cops say, which they tried to lie about a couple things. And the kid, now you could say, well, he's only 5 years old. I don't think that really makes a difference in this case. And I'll play the clip from the kid as far as what he had said happened, because they tried to claim that she used her son as a human shield and all of that bullshit. Now, why she didn't get him out the house, I don't know. And now, if she did, they probably would have just fucking, you know, of course, what do you call it? You know, just ransacked the house, just came right in, or picked her off with a sniper or whatever. So I don't know if she was thinking about that or if she was thinking about this is the last minutes I'm going to get to spend with my son or what. But as I said earlier, I don't think that through the situation she's the best parent, but I mean, in that situation, I don't know what's going through her mind. And, you know, obviously it's a very stressful situation when what they left out was, yes, the police and maybe this is legal in Maryland, but the fact that it's legal anywhere is, to me, violates the Constitution, but who cares? I know I had a friend who actually had a warrant for his arrest and was in his house and just wouldn't come to the door. So the police just waited outside and waited to see, you know, like went down the street and waited to see if he came out, and he, you know, knew they were watching for him. So I think he might have left out through the back and kind of snuck out if he needed to go anywhere. But that's the whole thing here. How can you go? Now he had a house, but still, how can you go to get the key to the house from the manager? To me, you know, if I move in another apartment, I'm going to change my fucking locks and not give it to him. I mean, the fact that they can get a key to your house, that the police just have to ask for it. Because as far as I know, there was no warrants. I mean, getting a judge's permission for something like that, I guess, is what it would be. A warrant to enter your house, they just sign off on them anyway. I mean, it doesn't mean anything. The Fourth Amendment doesn't mean shit. So they shouldn't have been able to enter the house. They used the key, but then they had the, you know, other locks on it. I think they're trying to say they had the, you know, sliding chain, the chain lock where the door opens a little. They might have had another extra lock on it. You know, who knows? Either way, they kicked the door in. And that's validated also by the son, but they admitted that later as well. So, and that makes a difference, even in breaking and entering cases, if the door is open or if you break something to enter a house. So they essentially broke into her house. They could have avoided that whole thing, and they could have waited, which to me is what should have been done until, you know, if you want. First of all, it's a bullshit warrant anyway. It's not that important. So, okay, they don't come to the door and come back later. And they had a warrant on her boyfriend, too. And he got out on personal recognizance. But however, there were articles that he was arrested later when they searched the house. Supposedly, they found a gun and heroin. So I don't know. As far as I know, they could have fucking planted that shit. Who knows? But from what I understand on his warrant, though, he got out on personal recognizance. So how serious was his warrant? I know it had to do with, you know, domestic shit with him and korrryn-gaines. So the warrants are not serious. Why should we be allowing police to just come in people's houses over warrants that aren't even serious? Do you think that's okay to be able to get a key to somebody's house and then break the door in over warrants that are over stupid shit that aren't serious? That in her case, there's no victim. It wasn't violent. It was, she didn't have a license plate on her car. And then she gave the police a hard time. In their mind. she could say the police gave her a hard time by harassing her and pulling her over in the first place. I'll go back to the clip.
The police.
And what are they trying to do? It's charging. What are they trying to do?
Police say when Gaines again pointed her shotgun at officers through the door, it prompted the exchange of gunfire. One shot by police, two shots from inside the apartment, three more shots by police. Korrryn Gaines was killed, her five-year-old son hit in the arm. It remains unclear if the boy was hit by police gunfire or by his...
Okay, first of all, that's all based on police testimony. The only thing we know for sure is that she owned a shotgun. She has video of her loading a shotgun. But I don't know when that was from. It wasn't from that day, I don't believe. But they tried to, of course, make it look like it was. So let's assume that she did have a shotgun. And I would believe that, I mean... And when I say that she did have a shotgun, that she had it, you know, she was holding it, I would assume that just because of the fact that the police, what would stop them from just grabbing her? And that's why. So that fact, I think we can accept that as a fact that she had a shotgun. Now, did she point it at police? Did she say, if you come in here, I'll kill you? Now, you can look at her tweets and texts, I think more her tweets that they showed, that sounds plausible that she would say that, but they're saying something different here than what they said in other reports and articles that she pointed it at them and said, if you guys don't leave, I'm going to kill you. And then they started shooting at her. So as far as how the shooting started, the only story that you're going to get is the story of the police. Now, they broke into her house. I mean, the fact that she had a warrant for some bullshit that I think they fucked with her on the court date, in my opinion, is irrelevant in this situation because they broke into her house over a stupid-ass fucking warrant. Why do that? It's obvious that they went after them because they could have just said, okay, fuck it, they didn't answer the door. Whatever, it's a bullshit warrant. We'll pick them up when we fucking pick them up. And they can do that. And when I was actually in jail for a couple days in Las Vegas for getting arrested for a bullshit offense and just waiting to get bailed out, there were people in there for similar shit that had warrants for jaywalking tickets that they didn't pay. And they actually went to their house. And they happen to be black as well. So is that a factor? Or do they go to everybody's house that has tickets for jaywalking? I don't know. However, I think, you know, in this case, that it was... They looked at her as she's one of those anti-government people. We're not going to, you know, leave. We're going to pick them up. Was it because they were black? I don't know that that had anything to do with it. Maybe, maybe not. It may have not. They may have just been going through warrants and going and picking people up. But still, if it was a warrant for murder, then that's a little different. or rape, but a warrant for what they had. If they don't come to the door, again, you know, you get them when you get them. Is the world in, were people in danger because of them? So, and, you know, some people say, yeah, they were, because look at what happened. Yeah, that's what happened when police came into our house. And again, we're basing it off of the police story that they even admit that they shot at her. They claim that she shot back. I don't know for a fact that she shot back. Maybe she did, maybe she didn't. If she did, she's defending herself. So it's self-defense, as far as I'm concerned, when the police break in your house and then, you know, you shoot them. But they had 7 hours of negotiation. And the whole thing, look at that, too. 7 hours of negotiation, supposedly, over a dumb fucking warrant. And I put that on the police. When they could be out solving real crimes, they're sitting there waiting for her to come out for fucking traffic warrants. Are you fucking kidding me? That's what they're doing? That's what they're getting paid for? And they had a whole SWAT team there. Just fucking go. But people think, oh, you can't do that. Why not? Just leave and you'll get her later.
His mother's, the boy, is listed in good condition tonight.
Wow. Megan. Trace, thank you. Joining me now, criminal defense attorney and former prosecutor Mark Eiglarsh and criminal rights and defense attorney Andel Brown. Wow. Mark?
Yeah.
That...
All her. Anybody who dares point the finger at law enforcement is either being intellectually dishonest or somehow really doesn't know the facts in this case. They were overly cautious. They could have shot her right away when they came in and then held back. 6 hours they waited. And when they came in, both with the words that she used, I will kill you, coupled with the action, not putting down this shotgun, they...
Well, that's what they say. And the only story you have is the police's. Maybe it's true, maybe it's not. But, you know, that's not... Just because... See, and this is, to me, a serious problem. Just because the police claim something, it doesn't make a fact at all. They all support each other. I've read police reports about myself, and they weren't even what happened. So maybe that's what happened. Maybe it's not. We do know the police shot and killed her. That's a fact. I believe that she did have a shotgun on her, and the fact that they didn't, you know, honestly shoot her right away is surprising. And why is that? So there may be more to this than we know. I don't know. And it might have just been because the kid was there.
They had to take action. She caused her death.
Andel, do you agree?
In a situation like this, a picture's worth 1,000 words and a video is priceless. Here, we have the police account of the events, but we also had police accounts in the Walter Scott case, Laquan McDonald case, Tamir Rice case, where facts that were reported did not match up once we had a video. When we have citizens who feel the need, like in the Philando Castile or the Alton Sterling, to record interactions with police because the body cameras fell off, they aren't working, or whatever the case may be, it shows we have an issue with the trust and transparency and accountability.
That's not what she asked.
Look at her. This is her with the gun. This is her with a shotgun, Mark Eiglarsh. That's on video.
That's what we're told. That's not what we see.
What?
So what are you suggesting, Andel? Are you going to manufacture facts?
What I'm suggesting
facts?
Is in a
Everything
city like
supports.
Baltimore
I'm looking
that was
at it
just
right
rocked
now.
With the Freddie Gray, there should be using body cameras in this case.
They just
should
got
be
the body cameras a couple of weeks ago. They're implementing that in Baltimore.
Well, great. We need to see what happened. That's all I can say. I
this
can't make assumptions
much,
like Mark that it's all
see?
Her
it's
without
how-
seeing what happened because I've seen police reports that turned out not to be true once we saw the video.
But Mark Eichler, okay. We are seeing. This is video from the moment this went down.
We can play Andel's generic game. I've made
Mark
it before.
That.
Hold on. Andel, we'll go with what you're saying. You could throw out that generic comment all day long. We never know because we weren't there. We haven't seen reports. And sometimes reports are wrong. You're correct. But here's the question. Based upon what they're reporting, are you conceding that this was a justified shooting?
Mark, what I'm saying is I'm not just going to go with what
the
they
answer
report.
Is yes
when
or
we
no.
Go into a, when
if,
we go into a court of
saying.
Law, Mark, you don't control this interview. When we go into a court of law, we make sure we're very sure before we take someone's freedom.
You just can't
we make
say
sure
the
we
word,
go through
you?
Many steps before we take someone's life.
And when Dale,
an
it was
officer's
a
making
okay.
those
hold
decisions,
on a second, guys.
The
on a
people
second.
Deserve
on.
To see
just
and
on.
Evaluate whether they're
to
correct
point.
Or incorrect.
Okay,
we
to
have to keep the government honest.
To your point, to Andel's point, the video of her loading up that gun was apparently from 2 weeks earlier. It wasn't this. This was 2 weeks earlier. It wasn't in the moment that she had the confrontation with the police, who say she did have the long gun, who you can hear discussing with her son on the video that they're she believes they're trying to kill her. And there's a question about her mental state, Mark. I mean, I don't know whether this woman was okay emotionally or mentally, and the police would not confirm whether she had a history of mental health issues. But here she is. Just a couple of weeks earlier when she had the confrontation with police, she was pulled over. She didn't have a license plate. She considered herself a sovereign citizen. She didn't recognize the authority of the U.S. law enforcement agents. She demanded to see their authority cards. And this is a confrontation. This is a piece of tape from back then. Watch. Joining me now, criminal defense attorney and former prosecutor Mark Eichler and criminal rights and defense attorney Andel Brown. Wow. Mark?
Yeah. That... All her. Anybody who dares.
Now we move to Baltimore County, Maryland, where police shot and killed 23-year-old korrryn-gaines on Monday. Gaines' 5-year-old son was also injured in the ordeal. Details are still surfacing of what happened in the hours leading up to the shooting and if the use of police force was excessive or not. There are reports that the Baltimore County Police Department deactivated Gaines' social media account during the time of the standoff. It's also being reported two videos she uploaded on Monday before she was shot and killed by police are no longer posted on her social media account. Now, this raises two questions. Was Gaines' freedom of speech violated? And will this be a new trend for law enforcement? Joining me now to discuss this further is our team multimedia editor, Alexander Rubenstein. Now, Alex. Many people rely on social media to voice their views, particularly in times of protests, of course, and in confrontation. Now, to name one of those as an example, we saw it in the case of Philando Castile. Now, what role did social media play in that incident?
Well, that was an interesting incident, Ashley, because the girlfriend of Philando Castile was able to preempt any attempt by police to create their own narrative on the situation. So what she did as soon as her boyfriend was shot was she pulled out her phone and started streaming live on Facebook. And so this was kind of the reverse of what happened in the case of korrryn-gaines, where the police were able to prevent her from live streaming on Facebook and basically form their own narrative, which has changed several times since the incident.
Okay. So in the case of Gaines with her social media account being deactivated now, would you consider this to be censorship or a violation of her freedom of speech?
I would say so, because the police are technically a government body, and the First Amendment to the United States Constitution obviously protects against infringement on speech by the government. And it's especially problematic given that Gaines was actually posting political content at the time. She referred to the police outside as a gang. So that creates an extra layer of problems. And also, I want to point out that the police were not wearing body cameras at the time. So in shutting down or having her account deactivated, they were basically able to ensure that the encounter was not filmed at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because in Baltimore County, they just started releasing these body cameras and outfitting their officers. So most officers are not going to be equipped. But if they were, we'd be able to answer a lot of questions that people have at the moment. Now, have you noticed any backlash on social media or by civil rights groups from this?
Both, actually. So first on Twitter, you know, there's a commonly referred to entity called Black Twitter. And there's some dispute on this incident where some people are saying, well, you know, she was completely unjustified and the police officers were justified in killing her because she had a gun pointed at them. However, people like Sean King have pointed out, you know, that race could quite easily be an issue in this situation, as dozens of white men actually pointed guns at police officers in the month of July and were able to get away without being shot or killed. The ACLU has also said that police put themselves at risk of deadly force in this incident, so they were legally justified in using deadly force in this incident. And, you know, so because they were justified in using deadly force, they were also justified in requesting that Facebook take down this video.
Okay, could we be looking at a trend? We see that the Baltimore County Police Department was able to get Facebook, a private company, to pull Corinne's videos from social media. First they deactivated and then may have pulled videos from her account. Now, could we be looking at a trend? Could this be happening again in the future?
Well, you know, it's a little bit weird to say that it could, ask if it could happen again, because it's happened thousands of times. In 2015 alone, there were 15,000 emergency requests sent to Facebook by law enforcement, 73% of which were honored. And it's not just in this country, too. Also in the nation of Israel, they have had quite a bit of success in stifling Palestinian activists on Facebook as well. And also, I want to point out that on Facebook, they typically respond to racism against white people faster than they do against black people. And one point that I'd like to make, a couple pages, some left-wing meme pages were shut down recently for suggesting that white people thought that avocados were spicy. Whereas, in contrast to that, there's the Blue Lives Matter Facebook page, which Max Blumenthal recently pointed out to Tom Hartman in an interview, where it's just a place for hate speech and incitements of violence to fester. So there is a double standard on Facebook oftentimes.
All right, thank you so much, Alex, for this insight. That was RT Multimedia Editor for the web, Alex Rubenstein.
Okay. What?
Take your time. Start from the beginning.
Okay. So, the police kicked the door down, and then I was hiding in the closet, and then my mother pulled the gun out, and then I was hiding in the closet, and then Corrine was hiding the door. So Carson was hiding the door, was walking. So my mother didn't want me to come out, so I come out, and then I had my camera, because it's just home, because I left it behind. It's a toy gun.
Mm-hmm.
And I was sitting next to my mother, and then we were sitting up there, and then the police didn't let us go to our rooms. So Corrine was gone, and so he took Carson. So the
he tried to take you with him?
Huh?
He wanted you to go with him?
No, I wanted to stay with my mother.
No, but Corrine wanted you to go with him?
Yes.
What'd you say, no?
No, I was just standing there. And then I wanted him a new phone, because he coming to give me a new phone.
So what happened? You ain't finished telling me the story.
So we sneak in the bathroom, and then I pull by. So my mother said back off, and then she did say back up. So the police said, please back up. And then they started shooting. And I sweat in the couch. And then the police just took me with her. And she died. P.M.
So they shot my sister?
Yes.
And they shot you too?
Yes. Because they saw me run. And then they hurt my arm.
So they shot you on purpose?
Yes. The end.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. That last clip there was her five-year-old son, Cody Gaines, who they claim that the police claim they shot him in the face. He says that he was shot in the arm. And somebody had interviewed the neighbor who had also said that the next-door neighbor who had also said that he was shot in the arm, and it looked like it in the video, because this was something that was posted on YouTube. And of course, I'm just playing the audio, as you can't see video. So the fact that she didn't have him go to the room at that point, I don't know. And him even getting shot, I mean, is fucked up that the police, it's bad enough that they had shot and killed her. Now they claim that she shot back. Maybe she did, maybe she didn't. I don't know. As far as her, you know, having the shotgun and telling them, he said that she told him to back up, but she could have said, if you don't leave, you know, I'll kill you, whatever. And them shooting a little kid, when you're talking about fucking, you know, snipers, and they show one of the guys, she got him on video, that was in the house, because they were actually at like the front door, and that they couldn't, if they were trying to shoot her, assuming she was shooting back. First of all, the fact that they couldn't take her out with one shot is another thing. They had claimed she shot back twice. And I've seen the shotgun. I have a similar shotgun. It doesn't have a, I forget what the thing's called. It just has the, like, it doesn't have the mount in the back. It just has the, you know, the trigger and the grip, and that's it. And no, it is not easy to fucking shoot. You need two hands for that damn thing. And this is like probably a, you know, 90, 100 pound girl. So I don't think I can shoot that with one hand. So there's no way she can. So the whole idea that she was holding her son at all is bullshit. They still ended up hitting him, and they claim she got off two shots after they fired at her. So the story, it doesn't make a lot of sense exactly how it happened, or they claim it happened. And I don't believe that they needed to shoot her, because get the fuck out of the house. And, you know, you're going to sit outside for a warrant. That's bullshit. You broke in somebody's house. Get the fuck out. And that's how I feel about it. And if she had shot at them, she was shot at. I mean, they're not claiming that she shot first. So if she shot first and they shot her, I still, you know, they shouldn't have been there in the first place. But I guess in those circumstances, they're not justified, in my opinion, in being in the house in the first place. So, yeah, they're defending themselves, but they're defending themselves in a situation they shouldn't be in. They should have never been in the house. The way this should have went is when they didn't answer the door, these were bullshit warrants. They should have said, fuck it. When they run into them, they'll arrest them at that time. And that's it. But they end up killing this girl, shooting a 5-year-old over what? They didn't like the way that she didn't bow down to them because she was non-compliant, because she doesn't believe in their authority. Where do they get their authority from? Well, they get their authority from the barrel of a gun. They get their authority from having a gang of motherfuckers backing them up. There's no consent of the governed. Somebody fucking said that today or yesterday, the consent of the governed. What consent? She didn't give consent. I don't give consent. Most people don't give consent, but they do whatever they want to do. So I do believe in the beginning that she probably should have just, you know, cut her losses there as far as not being arrested. Not that she knew later that she'd end up getting killed, but just because, and I mean, I respect the fact that she said, I'm not leaving this car, but it didn't seem like, I mean, you pick your battles, and that didn't seem like a battle to go through, but she wanted to do it and she did. And I don't fault her for that. And I don't fault her for if she did shoot back at the cops after being shot at, and for telling them, you know, if she had told them get out, or, you know, and I don't know why all of a sudden after 7 hours she'd say that, but there's a difference between saying it and making a move like she's going to fire on them. Plus, they could have just got the fuck out. But no, they didn't get out. They needed to stay there over a bullshit warrant. So, I mean, people might still totally disagree with me on this. And I'm sure there are a lot of people that totally disagree with me on this. But the point being is that there are a whole bunch of other things that the police could have done. And as far as I'm concerned, they broke into her house, violated her rights. Most likely, it was a misunderstanding on the court date, because if you watch the video, she's very adamant about making sure that she gets her court information and gets it to her lawyer and all of that stuff, showing that she was ready to go to court. That's something that she had planned on doing. So the cops doing what they were doing, and even her, like I said, her saying that, it's they could have left right there. And there's been standoffs in other situations. Of course, there's been people killed in them, like at Ruby Ridge, where multiple people were killed. And he actually pretty much won that case. I can't think of his name right now, but so I'd honestly look at her as somebody that stood up to the system and said, you're not going to come, you know, drew a line. Now, I again think that in the beginning, she should have just took the kids and fucking said, fuck it. Like I said, you pick your battles, but she chose to do what she wanted to do. And I think she, not even that, I'm not even going to say I think. I mean, she was in her rights. Somebody broke in her house just because they're government agents. And what is the police thinking here? Seriously. That we really need to arrest these people that bad, that we need to get a key, we need to go through this whole process, and, you know, because they have stupid-ass warrants. Like I said, because the process that I was aware of, and this is where they're infringing more on people's freedom, but it would be to, if somebody doesn't answer the door, you leave. Having an arrest warrant is not having a search warrant. Like when you have a search warrant, they supposedly have the right to, you know, bust your door down to search your house. An arrest warrant is not the same thing, because you don't know if that person's even fucking there. You think about the ramifications of that. They said they heard people. It doesn't mean it was even them. They could have had a babysitter and been out somewhere. So what you're saying is, and to me, this is a Supreme Court case, even though the Supreme Court is wasn't even supposed to decide shit like this. But if you have an arrest warrant for somebody and you think they're in somebody's house, you can just get the key to their house and then break their door down, because you think they're there? Is that okay? And then when they do that, when they break down your door, are you not allowed to defend yourself because they're government agents? Because the law says, well, the police can do whatever they want. So, you know, it doesn't matter that they broke down your door. You have to go to jail. And because now you know that they're police, it's okay that they broke down your door. You just go with them now. You get kidnapped by them now. I mean, what if she fucking opened fired when they broke in the door? People aren't looking at the other side of this as well, as the fact that she could have fired at them when they broke in the house in the first place. Now, she didn't do that, but she could have. As far as we know, she never fired at them, period. And I don't know that I believe she did. I believe she had a gun. I believe she probably pointed it towards them. I believe that she possibly said what they claim she said. I don't know if she said those exact words. As far as getting off two shotgun blasts, you mean to tell me that the police were able to, or that they, because they were pretty close to her, that they're that bad a shot that they were able to shoot her once, and she got two fucking shotgun rounds off of that fucking shotgun? Again, you know how hard that fucking thing is to fire? That ain't easy. Take a look at there's a video of her loading it, and it's not, you know, it's from like another time when she got it. And that's not an easy gun to fire. So this whole thing of believing whatever the police say and government media recognizing it as fact is bullshit. And you know, it's hard to, you know, look at what happened and you have a 23-year-old girl that is dead. You have a 5-year-old that got shot that lost his mother. And I don't know how old the other kid was. She had a daughter as well. And most of these people want to put it on her as opposed to, you know, putting it on the police. And you look at this. This is what the police are about. Filling jails, arresting people, going out I don't know what you'd call it, I guess, fulfilling outstanding warrants. They're not about protecting or keeping people safe or doing any of the things that we actually need in society. Were they in danger? Even if they were, that's your fucking job. Why are you sitting in the house then if you can't deal with the fact that, oh, I might have to fire a shot? Then get the fuck out. Why are you that close? If you feel that, oh, well, they could get in a situation where we could get in a situation where we might have to, you know, kill her or shoot her. And they shoot to kill, so never mind the, you know, shoot her. That's why I said that, how did they fire one shot and she was able to get off too? And nobody got hit with a shotgun, and we don't know how close they were neither, but they had fucking, you know, M16s or AR-15s. I mean, I saw one of the guys in the video. It's hard to see his gun, but I'm pretty sure that's what they had. I mean, they had SWAT teams in there. So you know, this to me, whether it had anything to do with race or not is irrelevant. I know people that have an agenda, that's what they use it for. To me, this is about, again, the police violating people's rights and taking somebody who they arrest for something stupid that you could argue shouldn't even be a law. Nobody agrees to this. They just tell you, hey, you have to pay this to register your car. Well, why do I have to pay to register my car? Don't I have a right to travel? But regardless, they didn't come to the door and they thought, hey, this is, we got to arrest these people for these stupid warrants and bring them in, and we'll break down the door if we have to do it. Well, if you're going to break down a door and you get shot doing it, you know, which they didn't, but I'm saying, you know, expect it. But the fact that they felt the need to fucking be in a position, this is what I don't get. So they were supposedly in range for her to shoot them, but weren't worried about. Yeah, I don't even get the whole tactical setup here. You know, there was one guy that they got on camera in the house. Then, of course, they shot the get Facebook and what's the other one? Instagram, I guess, to shut off her account. Unfortunately, she didn't. Maybe she could have created another one, but they probably had the phone. So, like, you know, it would have stopped her from using that phone. Or they could have shut off the cell phone towers in that immediate area, and we know they can do that. I'm surprised they didn't do that, to be honest, as opposed to, you know. So they made sure that there were no cameras. So I think that's really what a lot of people are looking at, that they don't know what happened. And that's where they're saying, you know, the police murdered her because... And either way, they put themselves in that position to be in a position where they felt they were unsafe. I don't know why they'd put themselves in a position where they feel in danger. I don't get it. They couldn't be outside somewhere where she couldn't, you know... They couldn't get out when she said to get out. It's better to shoot her. This is the whole fucking mentality of police. This is what police do. And you can all sit there and fucking say that, well, she deserved it because she didn't obey the police, you know, initially, right? Because she, you know, stayed in her car. And that you know, she sat there with a shotgun after police broke into her house, and that she's a bad mother, so she deserves to die. There's some fuckhead I have on tape that's just, well, she deserves it. She just deserves to die. It's fucked up. So, I mean, nothing's going to change because you have a group like Black Lives Matter that are making it all about race instead of about the police having this power that they have and being able to do whatever they want to whoever they want and get away with it. And they ignore all the other races that get killed and just focus on the black people to try to manipulate people. And I don't think as many people are as manipulated as they think they are, but there's a lot of people in this country. So, you know, you only need so many when you have 300 million and we're fucked. I mean, seriously, if people don't start standing up and, you know, stop complying with this bullshit, stop letting them get away with the shit that they're doing. And I'm not talking about like anything that happened in Dallas or Baton Rouge where people just went and randomly killed police. I'm not talking about that. That's fucked up to randomly, you know, take anybody's life. But I'm talking about real non-compliance over laws that matter. And you're not going to change things through the system. And when it comes down to it, if you have to defend yourself, you have to defend yourself. That's really the only thing I support is self-defense. I'd rather see things change without, you know, through peaceful protests. And I really don't think protests even do anything anymore. I think we're to that point that, you know, people just need to defend themselves in certain situations. I mean, like I said, you pick your battles, but there's no freedom anymore. Not that there ever was total freedom, but you know, the government can do whatever they want to you, so you can take that how you want. You can take it as, okay, I'm gonna just let them do whatever, or you can take it as, hey, I'm gonna stand up and, you know, when I need to. And that's really up to everybody out there. But hopefully, if you can change enough people's hearts and minds, like at the end in V for Vendetta, when they had just so many people out there that they just walked right over the guys with the guns. And they just didn't shoot them. That's ultimately the only way things are going to change. But to get there, I don't know what's going to happen during that time that some people are going to get hurt in the process. unfortunately, and that's what I think. But that's all the time we have for tonight. I'd like to thank everybody for tuning in. And I'm surprised I got through the show tonight because my stomach's been bothering me. But we will be back tomorrow to talk about the demands of Black Lives Matter in detail. And be sure to tune in on Thursday for Dale Brown from the Detroit Threat Management Center, where you could see actually real safety and protection without using violence. Thanks, everybody.
But at the end of the day, each and every member should go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer.